It's really very exciting for me to be here and to add one short story about Ernie Beutler. We know that he had endless contributions. One of them, which is less known, is the development of very effective chemotherapy, 2-CDA. And I was involved many years ago. I was trained by Bracha Ramot, very similar to Yair. And a candidate for chief of staff of the Israeli army suffered from hairy cell leukemia. And he was treated by interferon, which at that time was the conventional therapy for that, and he suffered the side effects, and really it destroyed his life. And then I saw the first abstract about 2-CDA in hairy cell leukemia by Ernie's group, and I showed it to Bracha and Itzik Ben Basatz. And 2 weeks later, Ernie Beutler came to visit us, and 3 weeks later, this general went to La Jolla and was among the first patients to be treated by 7 days of 2-CDA, and he became a chief of staff, and so it was one additional major contribution of Ernie. So our group is involved in the study of epigenetic modification, and as you all know, for 30 or 40 years, when we discussed epigenetics, we usually discussed either modification of DNA, the best studied is 5-methyl cytosine, and Chaim Sider here is among the pioneers in the field, and also modification of histones. However, it's about time to discuss also the role of RNA modifications in epigenetic regulation. And actually, until recently, we knew that there are a lot of modifications of RNA. However, the majority of them, we are aware of about 150 modifications of RNA, much more than the number of modifications in DNA. However, we could, or the scientists were able to analyze only those modifications that were found in highly abundant RNA molecules, such as tRNA and ribosomal RNA, and there was no efficient ways to look for modifications in low abundant RNA, such as messenger RNA. And then, in the last 15 years or so, our group and many other groups now are studying, using next-generation sequencing-based methodologies, modifications that affect messenger RNA, low non-coding RNA, etc. And actually, these are the main modifications in messenger RNA that are known now. There are two additional modifications on the way. And our group was involved in the identification of inosine, what is known as A2I, adenosine to inosine editing, M6A, and M1A. And I'll give you some few examples showing that during the short time of research, these very basic findings are being translated to clinically relevant findings. So actually, the story started 15 years ago when we started to look for A2I editing, adenosine to inosine editing. This was the PhD studies of Erez Levanon, a brilliant student at that time, now running his own lab at Bar-Ilan University. And A2I editing is very interesting. It's a simple deamination of adenosine to inosine. And while adenosine pairs with uridine in RNA, inosine is very similar to guanosine in structure and pairs with cytidine. Another important point to realize is that editing occurs only in double-stranded RNAs. Usually, DNA is double-stranded, RNA is single-stranded. However, there are many regions of complementarity inside RNA molecules that allow the editing enzymes, known as ADARs, to mediate this modification. And it was very simple to map global RNA editing for the first time, this was as well, because the sequencing machines also recognize I as G. And therefore, what we had to do at that time was to compare all the genomic sequences that were available to all the transcriptomic sequences that were available, looking for mismatch, having A in the DNA and G in the RNA, and turn out that indeed the majority of these mismatches represent editing from A to I. These are the editing-mediating enzymes in human. There are two versions, short and long, of other one. This is the major editing enzyme. And interestingly, and relevant to the rest of the discussion, is that other one long is induced by interferon. Then there is other two, which mediates mainly rare editing events in coding regions. And other three turn out recently to be a dominant negative inhibitor of editing. So there are few editing sites in coding regions that were linked to a variety of disorders. One of them is AZN1, which turned out to be very relevant to hepatocellular carcinoma, but also to other tumors. And this is a very nice mechanism. There is a protein known as antizyme that degrades two proteins that has to do with control of cell cycle, cyclin D and ornithine decarboxylase. The unedited AZN1 has no effect on antizyme. However, upon editing of the AZN1 messenger RNA, the protein that is produced is very efficient in sequestering antizyme. So therefore, if there is enough editing, there is sequestration of AZN1, of antizyme. Therefore, cyclin D and ornithine decarboxylase are not degraded, and they contribute to enhanced cell cycling and to malignant transformation. So this is one point where, one example how editing has to do with control of cancer. We know that there are many editing sites in the human transcriptome. In cancer cells, this is very efficient mechanism. So we have a set of mutations, or actually alterations, in the sequence of the RNA, which won't be found in the sequencing of DNA, because they occur during editing process. These days, we discuss a lot the cancer immunotherapy, which in many cases is dependent of neoantigens, new antigens that are expressed by the malignant cell and not by the non-malignant cells. So when considering immunotherapy, now we have to add to the mutations that result in neoantigen, also editing variants that also can be involved in the production of neoantigens and targets for therapy. When Seaborg group established mice with no other one, the major editing enzyme, the phenotype was lethal in day 11.5, and the phenotype was that of rapidly disintegrating liver and severe defects in definitive hematopoiesis. And the reason for that were not known at that time. Then, when we mapped for the first time the whole transcriptome editing, we realized that editing sites within coding regions are very low. We are aware of about 50 of them in human and mouse. However, the vast majority of editing events affect repetitive sequences, mainly ALU sequences, that are found in various transcripts in our epitranscriptome. And why these are the major targets of editing? This is a typical gene. In a typical human gene, there are 16 ALU sequences, and they are found in both orientations. Therefore, you'll find a lot of secondary structure that are the result of two complementing ALU sequences or other repetitive sequences. Remember that other one, the enzymes that mediate editing, can mediate this activity only on substrate which is double strand structure. Therefore, the majority of editing activity in the cell is that of repetitive sequences, in particular ALU. So if there is such a structures, the editing can change the secondary structure of such element. And why is that important? We know that as part of innate immunity, we have sensors, we have intercellular sensors that detect nucleic acid, and double-strand RNA is a very strong stimulator of innate immunity. So binding of double-strand RNA, mainly to MDA5, via activation of MAVs, result in activation of NF-kappa pathway and enhance interferon production. And a major function of editing seems to be the destabilization of double-strand RNA because of the editing that destabilizes this structure. This was a theory until recently, because as you know, it's not easy to predict alterations in the structure of RNA. So what we did, and it's mainly the work of Oz Solomon, a fantastic graduate student, we used a methodology that was developed by Howard Chang and Eran Segal to look for the secondary structure of RNA by next-generation sequencing. And the idea is very simple. You allow the RNA to fold, and then you digest the RNA either by an enzyme that digests single-strand sequences or by an enzyme that digests double strands. And then by next-generation sequencing, you map the structure. And without going into the details, you can map whole transcriptome, the secondary structure of RNA, and we did it in the same cells with and without inactivation of the other enzyme. And we came with few interesting conclusions. One is that endogenous inverted repeats can be either stabilized or destabilized by editing. However, perfect inverted repeats that have AU, which is stable, and do not contain AC, they are always in the editing, in this case, always result in destabilization. And therefore, when you have a viral sequences that have a complete double strand structure, they will activate the interferon system. However, then the interferon system will induce the long version of other one, and this, by editing, will shut off the system and prevent overactivation of the system. So there is a very strong evolutionary force to prevent the presence of double-strand structure. You'll find very low number of complete double-strand structures. These usually are new variants, and we believe that the major role of editing is to destabilize this double-strand structure to prevent overactivation of the immune system. One of the best examples for why this is important is a disease known as Aicardi-Goutier syndrome. This is a disease that affects young children and babies that present with an inflammatory syndrome, affect the brain, the immune system, the skin. For years, people were looking for congenital infection, and then it was realized that this is a genetic disorder. There are about 10 genes that are related to this syndrome, among them, other one. So if there is lack of other one, the mechanism that usually destabilizes the secondary structure of repeats is not working, and there is overactivation of interferon. This is known as interferonopathy. There are other diseases where similar mechanism is active. So usually, either viral or internal double-strand repeats activate the immune system, the interferon system. However, there is a negative feedback by activation of other one long and destabilization of the secondary structure. However, in Aicardi-Goutier syndrome and other conditions, There is defect in other one, there is lack of inactivation of signaling, and there is overactivation of the interferon system. This is also becoming relevant to modern immunotherapy because it was shown that interferon signaling induces the PD-L1 and PD-L2, which are the checkpoint that usually shut off the immune response to cancer. And therefore, the combination of modification of modulation of other one and anti-checkpoint inhibitor may be relevant to modern therapy. In the last few minutes, I would like to discuss another modification that we explored a few years ago. In this case, this is the work of Dan Dominicini and Sharon Moscovich that developed a methodology that allowed for the first time to map M6A, N6 methyladenosine in messenger RNA using capturing by antibody and next generation sequencing. It turned out that the distribution of M6A is non-random. The highest peak of methylation is around the stop codon at the beginning of the 3' UTR of messenger RNA. Also, very long exons are also highly decorated by M6A. And like any other epigenetic modification, we know that epigenetic modification are added, are marked by proteins known as writers. These modifications are eliminated by erasers, and there are also readers, proteins that bind the methylated or other type of modification and mediate the cellular activities of this modification. So the group of Chuan He were the first to map, to identify the demethylating enzymes, ALT-BH5 and FTO. The group of Boker identified for the first time the major methylase, or at least the functional subunit of the methylase. And our group identified the readers, those proteins that bind the methylated M6A in messenger RNA and mediates the cellular activities. And we know today that there are two major subgroups of proteins that are involved in this reading of M6A. One is the YTH protein, the other one is HNRNP-C proteins. And this modification is now known to be involved in practically any stage in the life of messenger RNA, starting in the nascent RNA from transcription and stabilization of the messenger RNA, the level of translation, localization in the cell, splicing, it particularly alternative splicing, and more. And it's not surprising that this major epigenetic regulation has to do with the control of self-phase decisions like the decision of early embryogenesis, and with the help of the group of Jacob Hanna at the Weizmann, we established knockout mice for the methylase, the METTL3, and turn out that you don't need methylation for the very early naive embryonic stem cells. Only during early stages of differentiation that are mimicked by embryoid bodies, you need methylation. So this is the wild type METTL3, and you see the typical cavitation in the embryoid bodies, and you see in the knockout, there is no cavitation and there is no differentiation. And also in complementation assay, where you inject to blastocyst either wild-type or knockout embryonic stem cells marked by mCherry, you see that in the wild-type, the injected cells contribute practically to any tissue of the embryo, while in the knockout, there is no contribution. So you must have methylation for development, but not for the very immature, naive stem cells. So it turned out the mechanism by which methylation affects self-aid decision. It affects various processes, but in particular, it has to do with degradation of particular set of proteins. In the case of embryonic stem cells, a set of about 30 transcripts that are involved in stem cell, in stemness, and have to be degraded for the cell to undergo maturation. And this very recently turned out to be relevant also to a variety of tumors. Without going into the details, there are more and more indication that it has to do with glioblastoma multiforme, with various type of leukemias, and probably more to come. So I'll stop here just to thank the people from our lab that were involved in this story. I mentioned Dan Domenicini, Sharon Moscovich, Ninetta Marilio is the head of the group. In Bar-Ilan University, we are collaborating with Erez Levanonin and his group. We have very close collaboration with the group of Chuanhe at University of Chicago and with Joseph Pulizzi in Stanford. I didn't mention, but we use their expertise in single cell analysis of translation and the role of modifications in this part. Thank you very much.